You know, those of you that came to Canada, it was their Thanksgiving. And we spoke about what are some of the reasons why we don't give thanks up there. Today, I'm not going to talk about that, but I want us to look into the biblical reasons why we should give thanks. Now, there are scientific reasons why we should give thanks. You know that. At pretty much every Thanksgiving, I share with you some study that proves that people that live a thankful life, people that are thankful rather than complainers, people that have a positive attitude rather than a negative one, live longer, they have more productive, fruitful lives, they suffer less from depression and anxiety, their memory function is superior, their immune system is better, their heart health is better. These are all individual studies that has been done throughout the years. And just recently, a couple of months ago, UCLA did a big study of all the studies to prove that they studied like 26,000 people. And everything I said has been proven yet again. So there is no question that being thankful, and when I say being thankful, I don't mean just saying thank you to people. I'm not talking about being polite. Right? When the Bible says, be continuously thankful. Pray with us without ceasing, in every circumstance, give thanks. Right? When the Bible says, in every circumstance, give thanks, constantly be thankful. When Apostle Paul says, in every situation, think of whatever is good and pure and holy and of good report. Think of these good things all the time. They don't mean just to say thank you to somebody. It's beyond being polite. It is who we are on the inside, not who we have to be seen like on the outside. Big difference. That's what the Bible is teaching us. In our core, in our soul, in our hearts. It's telling us to be positive, thankful people that have an attitude of gratitude as a part of their character. Now, none of us are naturally born that way. This is something we have to learn. And this is Thanksgiving season is an opportunity for us to be reminded of how easily we fall into the trap of complaining, grumbling, and being negative, and being a contrarian. We need to be a different group of people because we're called to be a positive. We're called to be a gratitude-filled people because of our Lord. But again, not on the outside, not saying thank you to somebody because they held the door open for you or did something nice to you. I'm talking beyond politeness, on the inside in our core. What are some of the reasons, biblical reasons, why we should be grateful? One, Psalm 136:1. God, I give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. They just sang about this. His love endures forever. When you're going through difficulties, his love endures forever. when we get up tomorrow morning, be mindful that His love endures forever. It's not only today, it's not only tomorrow, it's not only as long as we live. His love endures forever. Before the heavens were made, before you were conceived, before you lived your life, after we all pass away, His love will continue towards us, towards His people. Gratitude for salvation through Christ is another reason. He's a loving God and He saved us. Ephesians 2, 8 and 9, one of the most famous verses, "For it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not from yourselves." You didn't manage this. This is not of your efforts and putting together your engineering. No. It's a gift of God. Not by works, so no one can boast. Salvation was something that was given to you, not because you deserved it. When I say you, I mean me. Not because we deserved it, not because we did something good that made us qualify for salvation, simply because of His love for us. These undeserving, ungrateful, contrary creatures that we are did not deserve to be with Him in eternity, but yet, because of His love that endures forever, through Christ, He saved us. When we're living our everyday life, it's difficult to appreciate eternity, because we are so bogged down in survival mode of this life that we don't tend to think what's coming in the life to be. Yesterday, I went to a funeral of a believer who was a super nice guy. I knew him for many years. He was an accomplished doctor. His wife was a believer for many years. It took him 30 years to come to faith. I was there for his baptism. Whole church used to pray for him to come to faith. And he should have heard the applause when he was baptized about 9 years ago or something. Not that he was a bad guy before. He was a very nice guy. Family man, loving, caring. But he came to a point where he understood that he needed to be forgiven. But the point yesterday was, the church was full of hundreds of people. The certainty that his wife had was the difference. You see, yes, it was sad to lose him after a battle with cancer. He was 82 years old. He would run 5 miles every day, by the way. If he was super healthy, this cancer came out of the blue. But the point was, right on the day that he passed, he opened his eyes and he was singing a hymn. That was the last thing he did. And there was a smile on his face. Yes, it was sad for his wife and his kids to be parted from him, his grandkids. But they had the assurance of knowing that they're going to see him again. You see, it's only in those instances maybe we slow down and think. But in our schooling and everything that we're trying to get done, and we're planning our future and our job that we start, or the family we start, and the kids and the grandkids and all the plans and everything else, we tend to lose sight of eternity. We tend to lose sight of how necessary it is to be thankful to this loving God that loves us forever, who died for us. That's why we come together. That's why maybe it feels like we repeat this every time. Maybe it feels like you guys are probably saying, Steve, we heard this a million times. But, you know, it helps to be reminded that there is an eternity. And how are we going to get there is the question, not what we're going to do. We all have these achievements with this guy I'm not talking about. Great achievements all his life. He was one of the top guys for pharmaceutical companies. He tried retiring 4 times. They would call him back because he was the one that would explain how medicine worked to groups of hospitals and this and that. So he was very knowledgeable, very well liked. But so what? What does that mean today? Unless he's with his Lord. And he is with his Lord. He had that confession. So I'm saying this to remind you, don't lose yourselves in the world and in the endeavors. Yes, do the best you can, but don't let that define who you are. Remember who you are. Remember whose you are. Remember eternity. Remember his standards, his values. Remember what he's telling you to do. Yes, we should be thankful for salvation. We should also be thankful for his provision. Philippians 4:19 says, "And my God will meet all your needs according to his riches in his glory in Christ Jesus." You know, I can testify to this. There's been many years where it was difficult for us. But God provided everything without fail. It made no earthly sense. It made no financial or math sense. Because you have this much coming in, you have this many expenses, yet you still meet it. How? My pastor at the time had said, Steve, he said, this is what we call when God is cooking the books. Because you have one coming in and you're spending 5. How is that physically possible? He meets it, he does it, he did it. If I was to speak to all of you, those of you especially who's been walking with the Lord for a while, you will probably testify to the same, that God met you every single step, that you were missing nothing. Maybe you didn't have everything you wanted to have, but everything you needed. For my God will meet all your needs according to his riches of his glory in Christ Jesus. And he does. So we must be thankful. Because he does meet everything that we need. Book of James says, every good and perfect gift comes from above. Is there anything good in your life? I'm sorry to say, it's not your accomplishment. Is there anything positive about you? Do you have an ability that others don't? That's not your accomplishment. Are you disciplined in a certain way of working? Or do you have an ability that others don't have in the way of creating things? That's not your doing. Do you have the drive to practice it, hone it, and make it better? that comes from within you? Do you think you created that desire? That was given to you by God. Anything we have that's good, if we start taking pride in it, it will turn to ashes. Because we're thinking that, hey, we did this. It's kind of like a software program that's written that performs a certain task. Can you imagine that program taking pride on what he does? Who's the one that should be prideful of that program? The person that wrote the program, that created it, told it what to do, gave it the ability to do the calculations that it did. It would be silly. It would be kind of like a knife that's really sharp, that's able to slice through thick pieces of meat without any effort. Can you imagine that knife saying, hey, look how sharp, how good I am, look what I am able to do. No, it's the knife maker that made that knife that way. In the same way, any ability we have. Well, I'm not like this person. Well, where did that come from? Why is it so much easier for you versus the other person? Yes, we do have a part in it. We have to make the right choice. But dare I say, please hear me right in this. Even in that choice, we can't take pride in. Everything that's good in us, that we have, or we are, is a gift. Well, I don't do this and that and the other thing. That's wonderful. That's great. But why is it so much easier for you than other people? Even in that, don't take pride, because it's a gift to you. From a loving God who died for us, he gave us everything we need. How can we take pride in something that we ourselves did not do? Gratitude, thanksgiving, is a humbling time. We give thanks for things or to people, acknowledging that without that, life would not be the same. In a certain way, whatever this person and these people or this institution or our Lord did for us, made us better in some way, completed us in some way. It could be minute, it won't be, might be great, but in whatever way, it was their giving it to us or for us that made a difference. Gratitude for God's presence in our life is also necessary. Joshua 1:9. Have I not commanded you, says the Lord to Joshua? Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. For the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go. This God who loves us forever, who died for us, who gave us everything good, he sustains us in every situation, is with us all the time. We are told, if God is for you, who can be against you? God is for us. He is with us. So living a discouraged and fearful life is not one for a Christian. A discouraged, a fearful life is not for you. A discouraged, a fearful life is not for a follower of Christ. Why? Because he is with us. This knowledge needs to penetrate our minds and our thoughts and our hearts, our feelings, so that with confidence, boldly, we can make the decisions God wants us to make. Big highlight, underline, parentheses, circle. Be courageous and unafraid to do the things that God is telling us to do, not we want to do. God told Joshua, go circle the city 7 times and the wall will fall down. Courageously go. Do it. If it was up to Joshua, Joshua would probably try to go in through under the city to kill the soldiers and try to take it from within because he couldn't penetrate the walls. God didn't tell him to go boldly do that and don't be afraid, no. But God told him to do what God is telling him to do without being afraid. I've heard this verse used to encourage people to be courageous and give them encouragement to do whatever they wanted. That would be a misapplication of this verse. This verse is there to remind us whatever God tells you, He's with you. Don't be afraid and make the right decision. It might be difficult to end that relationship, but make the right decision. It might be difficult to quit the job, but make the decision. It's the right thing to do if the God is telling you. God is with you. Don't be afraid. Do the right thing. Do what He's telling you. And because of His presence, we're thankful. And gratitude for spiritual growth and guidance. James 1, verses 2 through 4 says, consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of many kind, because you know that the testing of your faith produces endurance. Let perseverance finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking in anything. Our challenges, our trials, our opportunities for spiritual growth. Have you looked at the problems in your life as an opportunity? Like James says, have you looked at it as a source of pure joy? Well, I sure didn't. I don't still. No. But if you're walking with the Lord, doing what He's telling you to do, examples are many. We all have areas in our lives that we know God doesn't want us to go down that path. But we kind of rationalize and make excuses and continue. I'm here to remind you, whatever the Lord is telling you to do, don't be afraid, do it. And as a result, if you go through trials of many kinds, be happy. Because God's doing something in there. Look, if I did what God is telling me not to do and I'm being persecuted for it, that's not what James is talking about. That's not what Joshua is talking about. Even though God can take those situations and teach you something, but that's not what we're talking about here. What we're talking about is doing what God is telling us to do, yet something unexpected happens. In those situations, God is growing us. And for that, we should be thankful. And one more thing is to be thankful for our church family, our community. Fellowship. Let us consider, Hebrews 10:24 says, how we may spur one another towards love and good deeds, not giving up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. As days are getting closer and closer for God's return, continue meeting together and be thankful, because there are many people that don't have a home church. There are many people that don't have a church family. What's worse, there are some people, they don't think that they need a church family. They think they could be solo Christians. You know, I could go to any church I want as long as I'm a believer. Technically, yes, but no. Everybody needs a family. To do what? To spur one another towards love and good deeds. To encourage one another, to help one another, to work together, to do what the Lord is telling us to do. And we should be thankful for that. And the last point is, we should be grateful for eternal hope. 1 Peter 1:3-4 says, "Praise be to Lord our God. In his great mercy, he has given us a new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, onto an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade. This inheritance is kept in heaven for you. Our ultimate hope lies in the resurrection. It's not for this world." I mentioned to you the hope that the widow had. If you were to go to a funeral of an unbeliever, the picture would be very different. The widow, kids, or the grandkids would be distraught, because as far as they know, they're never going to see this person again. It's hopeless for them. But we, as believers, we have a living hope. Our hope is alive. Those of you who have gone before us in Christ, we will see again. And we will see them in a way that is so much better than the way they were here, in their glorified form. We will be in our glorified form, and we will be with them forever, with the Lord. So, in conclusion, thankfulness must be a character attribute, not a superficial shell for a believer. It should come from within. We shouldn't just put it on. It should radiate from within rather than paint it on. So what this means for you in your individual lives, in your individual character, is different for everybody. But it's up to us to try to figure out what it means to be that kind of a thankful, positive, real person. We all have work to do. I know I do. You all do as well. So let's take this time, maybe until the end of this year, with prayer and fasting, ask the Lord, "Lord, in what are the motivations I need to change to be more thankful? What are the thinking patterns I have? Show me that are not fitting you. How can I be a truly, not seemingly, but truly thankful person? Show me what that means, what I need to change within me." And ask him, and as he shows you, start making those changes. Hopefully, next year, this time, we will all be more thankful and positive people. God bless you.